Bonjour à tous, je vais laisser du coup Guillaume présenter Marcus. Vas-y, je te laisse la parole, Guillaume, du coup.
Oui, bonjour à tous. Alors, je suis désolé, je suis dans le train, mais je vais laisser la place à Marcus. Donc, Marcus, c'est un adaptateur qui est suisse, qui a accepté de nous faire une présentation sur sa pratique quotidienne, notamment sur les syndromes secs et l'adaptation en antisclérale. Il est fellow of the Academy of Optometry in the US. Il est aussi fellow en la BCLA et aussi pour l'association des Suisses, des optométristes suisses. Il va parler en anglais, bien sûr. N'hésitez pas à communiquer vos questions sur le chat et puis nous ferons la traduction si besoin. Voilà. So now, Marcus, it's up to you, and so you have your time. It's okay for you.
All right. Thank you very much for inviting me, Guillaume. Thank you all for being here, taking your time about my talk for scleral lenses. Sorry, my French is not as good as my English. I was taught French in school, but no, I'm not good in French. So I do my talk in English. Now we need to go, that's here. So I manage the specialty lens clinic in Switzerland. We do a lot of specialty lenses there. About 85% are specialty lenses of our fits. A lot of scleral lenses, about 60% of these. We do also the RGPs and some of the myopia control. That's the current clinic in Tägerwilen, located north Switzerland, close to Konstanz at the border to Germany. We have two fitting rooms, some equipment to do the measurements, and we're building a new clinic now in Frauenfeld. It's going to be open by July, mid of July, where we have more room. So we dislocate and move to Frauenfeld in this area. I'm also an employee of Falke Linsen AG, and so all the lens fits were made with Falke Linsen, but it's not a matter because it's a general talk, so we don't discuss any geometries or details in these matters. So briefly, what equipment do you need to have? It's good to have a slit lamp with a digital photo, so you can have the images to look at later on. A cobalt blue filter, that's also nice to have because of the fluorescent images, but that's probably standard with you. And you need to have a good fitting set for scleral lenses to put on your patient's eyes. Nice to have is topography, but you probably have topography. But OCT, I do since about 3 years. I did all my fits before just with slit lamp, and it's working too. But now, having these skills without OCT, I can improve my skills with OCT technology with the anterior segment. So it's a benefit for me. Then there are also topography tools for the scleral topography, the Eaglet Eye Surface Profiler, or the Pentacam has a new tool, and America has the SMAP to measure the sclera. Whoops. We just run over the basics of scleral lenses, but I want to dig deeper than with cases where you can apply scleral lenses. My talk is actually, I want to inspire you. I want to give you ideas where to fit sclerals and where you can help your patients with sclerals and what rules cannot be applied, but what rules wouldn't work in certain cases. So we have a scleral lens that is vaulting over the cornea. We don't want to have a touch on the corneal surface, neither we want to touch the limbal area, and we want to have a good resting area on the sclera. So going back, what is an appropriate or ideal fit on the central cornea? About 150 to 250 of clearance in microns. The larger the clearance, the less oxygen can be transmitted to the cornea, and oftentimes also visual acuity decreases. So here an image of a OCT on the left hand and a fluorescein image of the same eye with the lens in place. On the limbal area, we want to have a clear limbal area to not interrupt the stem cells there. About 10 to 40 microns clearance would be appropriate or ideal. If you have more of clearance, then usually you have debris underneath from goblet cells that are located at the limbal area. So you have midday fogging and other issues. If you have too much clearance, also conjunctiva can slip under the lens. We talk about prolapse or folds underneath the lens. So we want to avoid that if possible. On the sclera, we want to have a circumferential good resting on the eye, no blanching, that means no vessels that are cut off, and imprints if you remove the lens, depending how soft the conjunctival tissue is. And apply toric scleral zones or even quadrant specific if needed to have an appropriate fit. So scleral lenses in a perfect world. We don't want to have midday fogging, a perfectly clear reservoir. We want to have a beautiful wetting surface. We don't want to have any staining on the cornea and the conjunctiva after removal. No imprints on the cornea and the conjunctiva, no redness, no rebones, and so on. That's all what we're aiming for. That's all good. But do we live really in a perfect world? And if you fit specialty contact lenses, then you know the world isn't perfect because the eye with keratoconus, it's not a perfect eye, for example. So in an imperfect world, the cornea situation usually gets further away of what we usually want to have the lens fit desired. Nevertheless, an ideal fit can and has to be achieved. And some of the compromises have to be undergone. So the question always is, what compromises can you take and what is a no-go? In these cases, I do more follow-ups, tighter follow-up intervals, maybe 3 months, but at least every 6 months, I will check the patient and the fit of the lens. Why do we do scleral lenses? It's for most of the time visual rehabilitation. We are looking into cases later on for other indications. And just a brief reminder of the optics. We have a corneal surface that is responsible for about 66% of the light refraction that happens in the eye. So if we have any irregularity there, is it on the tear film, the corneal surface, that will result in a bad retinal image or bad optics. So therefore, the only non-invasive way to correct those irregularities is by using scleral lenses or RGB lenses, hybrid lenses that work in the same manner. What situations can the lenses be applied for? I mean, there are obvious reasons which you probably already have fits to, like keratoconus, post keratoplasty, then LASIK with complications or refractive needs, radial keratotomy, or scars after trauma or infection that results in a irregular corneal surface. But also exposition keratitis, severe dry eye conditions can be fit with scleral lenses. And maybe a niche would be cosmetic indications where we have iris defects or do the lens partial occluded or fully occluded as a prosthetic lens. And we will look at some samples and cases later on. Also, we can use scleral lenses if an RGB lens wouldn't be accepted comfort-wise, or we have a lot of 3 and 9 staining because of the lens edges and so on. I also fit eyes with high refractive error, especially with high astigmatism. because if you have a toric haptic design, the lens wouldn't turn as it would with a soft lens, for example, and you have the same comfort as with a soft lens. So it can also be applied in sports or jobs with dust environments and a high visual demand. It's not like for everyone I would start fitting with scleral lenses, but in some cases it's a huge benefit for those. And me myself, and I am a scleral lens wearer because I have astigmatism about 2 diopter soft lenses and computer and some dry eye, it doesn't work. And then I'm a little bit sensitive on my eyes. I'm a bit of a sissy, so I cannot wear my RGB lenses. So let's look into the indications. The classic indication, that's one of the famous mountains in Switzerland at the center near Lucerne, the Rigi. We see the topography, it's not a nice cupola or ball. And if we compare it to our topographies in Kerakon, it's oftentimes looking the same. So that's a real case, a keratoconic eye. He was using long time RGP lenses. We had a good fit of those lenses. He hardly ever lost them or they displaced on the eye, but comfort wise and visual acuity was always an issue. And also sometimes erosions on the apex. And it's a very steep corneal surface. We have base curves of 5.4 millimeters. And those lenses, they cannot move a lot if they're fitted quite large to have a good comfort. So in this case, we fitted him with 2 scleral lenses. We have a minimal clearance at the apex at the end of the day. But that's good enough because we don't touch and we don't want to have excessive clearance in the peripheral cornea. So I think that's one of the classic cases where you would fit scleral lenses. And he had better visual acuity with the lens, a more stable fit and more comfort overall. So scleral lenses, I would say they're well suited for medium to high grade keratoconus. Mostly the visual acuity is better, and that's due to the fit. Not with every blink the lens also moves and the optics move. We have a stable optics in the eye, so visual acuity oftentimes improves two lines. Be aware with visual acuity forecasts in mild keratoconus, especially if you have a high posterior float, meaning the keratoconus is more on the back surface of the eye. If you correct some of the keratoconic surface on the front side, oftentimes a higher error is created with these eyes. And in these eyes, oftentimes soft lenses can be a good option, but it's only with mild keratoconic eyes. And then there is a cerebral keratoconus, what I call it. Those people, they have had that optic for years, and you put them a scleral lens on their eyes, they have a perfect optic, maybe, but they cannot just adapt with the new optic or the new vision, maybe too much of inputs. So those cases exist too. And you can go back to the older solutions and they're quite happy still. In keratoconus with cross-linked eyes, you can start earlier to wear lenses again after the surgery, with epi on even after 2 to 3 weeks, because we don't have a fully removed epithelium, and but have a talk to the surgeon who does it, when are the lenses or can be worn again. And I think in progressive keratoconus, where you want to follow up and look for pachymetry or topography, you don't have as much lens abstinence days necessary because you don't touch the cornea as much as you would do with RGP lenses. So that could be a benefit too. So I skipped one case because it was a regular keratoconic case. So we start with a second case. Intracorneal ring segments. That's a hate love of mine. I try to fit with RGPs in many cases. It's working okay, but it's a interesting topography. You have a cone, you have a flat area from the ring segment, and then you have a regular cornea in the periphery. So in these cases, oftentimes it's easier to fit with glare lenses. And in this case, he is unilateral keratoconic. So only on the right eye, he has an irregular topography. He was underwent cross-linking, and at the same time, he got intracorneal ring segment. I must say it was not in Switzerland. It was more east of Switzerland. We don't do a lot of these ring segments, fortunately, in the area I work. So those are the two eyes. And if you see where the ring segments are, we will come across other issues. And here, just a teaser, I'm a huge advocate of retinoscopy. So if you have a retinoscope, then use it and have a look at the optics. Can you appreciate the ring segments that are visible? I play it again. So I use dot retinoscopy, not line retinoscopy. I have a better overview what optics I can see, or what the patient can see, and what visual acuity I can expect. So with every patient, I use retinoscopy, and even with soft lenses or bifocals or ortho-K, you see if the lens is decentered, you see so much. You see if you have a cataract, if you have any other opacities in the eye. So please, if you have a retinoscope, use it more often. It's a huge help in my practice. So here we will have visual disturbances at night. So that's not dilated pupils, it's under just dim room lights. And yeah, it's the diameter of the rings, the inner diameter is just too small. So we won't get rid of that. If we know that ahead of time, then we can instruct the patient and say, see, we can help you, but not all of the problems will be solved by the lens. In this case, the lens was fitted nicely, and we had an increase from no lens visual acuity 0.2 to 1.2 partially. And in monocular cases, it's easier to fit with scleral lenses because of the comfort differences. So if you have one eye with an RGP lens and the other eye no lens, then it's oftentimes more difficult for the patient to accept it. Yeah, so we talked about that already. I make an appendix for keratocone and then we leave it. Briefly touched on that. You don't want to have a touch on the apex. That's usually the thinnest part of the cornea. We already have some scarring there. We don't want to have any more scarring. So at the end of the day, just make sure that the lens doesn't touch the eye. So I always look in white light in an optical beam if the lens is not touching the eye or not before removing the lens, because after you remove the lens, you have a higher sag again, or higher clearance than you would have after a day of wearing. My experience is below 50 microns, it's hard to tell on slit lamp. Maybe it's my slit lamp, but it's hard to tell if you have a cleared area or not, if you don't have any fluorescein underneath the lens. So in these cases, I see a huge benefit in the OCT technology. I can make sure, no, we don't have a touch. Even if you have 40 or 20 microns, that's working fine. That's enlarged. Then a subcategory of keratoconus is the pellucidal marginal degeneration. And that's also a difficult case to fit. Oftentimes, or most of the time, you have a compromise fit there with any type of lens. Maybe you can use soft lenses, then it's working better. But if you have the apex so low in the eye and you fit a scleral lens, you will either touch at the bottom or near the apex, or you vault the apex, but then you have too much clearance in the limbal area, or you have too much clearance at the center of the cornea. So you can choose what compromise is the best in that situation. This is a mild to moderate pellucidal marginal degeneration. A good fit at the center, not too much cleared. Here we have the the four quadrants with the rest of the lens on the sclera. And you see in the bottom part, okay, that's okay in this case. But in cases with a bigger ectasia, then you will either come very steep down or you touch the apex. Here we have the apex clear by a little bit, but that's okay. That's a bit more of a severe pellucidal, and we have a slight touch, as you can see here, in the fluorescein staining. There's no positive staining, which I'm always looking for. I don't want to have positive staining, but in some cases, I cannot vault all of the cornea, so in certain areas, there are slight touches. What I always make sure is that we have like very smooth transitions from the curve. So we don't have any hard edges there, because that could create any friction or staining on the cornea. Now we are looking at corneal conditions after surgery, such as perforating keratoplasty, lamellar graft restoration, and so on. Here the challenges often get more difficult, because we have steps of the graft, we have decentered grafts, and then we also have the endothelial cell count that is oftentimes already reduced and can be a limitation of scleral lens fitting. Then we have grafts that are restored, so you open the old suture because it's thinned out and you stitch it back together. Or then we have the radial keratotomy post-LASIK patients, where we have a very flat corneal center and then a normal corneal periphery. So here the variations and possibilities open, and my approach is use the scleral lens of a perfect world. So my fitting skills that I use with normal or relatively normalize and apply it in an imperfect world with the least possible compromises. And the skills, they are necessary, and do close follow-ups and follow-ups. Here we have a deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty after a scarring due to an infection. So we have a unilateral situation with irregularity that's on the left eye. It's not too bad, actually. You could fit a GP lens, that is an option too, but it always will center, decenter, because the graft position is decentered. If you have an edge, or if you have a transition point at the superior part of the cornea, that's also always a difficult thing to clear this area. We have gravitational forces that pull the lens down. Then we have lid forces that pull the lens down. And so oftentimes you cannot avoid touching if the most prominent part of the cornea is at the superior part. And we have no fluorescein positive staining on this eye with the lens. In the OCT, it looks like that. And I asked the online community what they think. Can we touch this or not? And that's the question here. So, and other voices would say, maybe like that, yes, we can.
Yes, we can. It's opportunity and prosperity.
Well, the question remains, can we touch or can't we touch? And that's always a question that's popping up with pathological cases. If, as I mentioned, if you have no staining, then I would leave it. I would do a regular follow-up. And in this case, it worked fine over a few years already. And we'll have a look at it every 6 months with this patient. This is a case where the patient had an old graft. It was very thin at the bottom part, so it shifted out and it was very prominent. So we fit RTP lenses with a very strange shape, but it would work. But the surgeon was preparing us or the patient to cut the lower part of the cornea and set new sutures there. So we were told to fit the scleral lens ahead of so that after the surgery she can wear the lens right away. So we have a nice cleared area here, and after the surgery this little maybe 70 microns clearance were increased to 1 millimeter, which is 1,000 microns. So the eye got a lot flatter and we had to restart the fitting procedure again. Here you can see the suture and the stitches still in place, and the surgeon gave us green light to do a fit of the lens so that the patient can wear the lens with steroids still in place and the sutures. That's oftentimes after keratoplasty, if it's a fully perforating keratoplasty or partially, we will have a very flat area in the center. Then we have the suture, which creates like a Fulcano edge. And then we have a very steep periphery. So this is also a situation that's very difficult to be not too much cleared and not touch any of the eye. And here we had slight touch horizontally, which was still fluorescein negative. The lens was good in place. We didn't have excessive clearance at the center to have enough oxygen transmissibility through the tear film. So in this case, it worked fine. Also, 3 months intervals are here required and a good relationship to the surgeon that build up trust on both sides. So depending on the surgeon, depending on the situation, we fit lenses on top of sutures. We try to not touch the graft area, and the people, they are happy to see again, because otherwise they would not see with their eye until the stitches are removed about 1 or 1.5 years later. Let's switch to another interesting situations. I don't know how much of those you see. We had a surgeon in Italy and in Russia who love to do those, and they go well for some years, but then they go off. And I try to fit RTPs in those eyes, but the cornea is so flat that every lens will just slide down. You don't have any centration properties of a lens. So now I will switch to scleral lens right away in those cases. Here the typical image with our astigmatism correction that worked maybe at the beginning. And here with a scleral lens in place and after removing the lens. The problem is, or the challenge is that we have a flat cornea and we usually don't have like 9 millimeter back surface curves of the scleral lens. So we oftentimes have too much clearance there. You have to talk to your lab how you can solve that issue. So as said, I would start right away with scleral lenses in those situations. And yeah, because these eyes oftentimes have a huge fluctuation of power within a day with glasses and so on. This case is a granular corneal dystrophy type 1. And I fit him with RGP lenses. We achieved a quite good visual acuity, maybe 0.8. With some glare at night, but the granular increased due to the dystrophy and he underwent a phototherapeutic keratotomy. And that was the topography before, and that was the topography after. He went to the ophthalmologist and he referred it back to us, and with the advice, please try soft lenses, but you anyway have to do a graft in this patient. So yeah, I did put a soft lens on top of that eye just to satisfy the eye doctor, but I was sure that it wouldn't help. And so we switched over to scleral lenses back away from the RGP lenses because we have an irregular surface and I was afraid that we can have punctural erosions on those parts. He complained of double vision, and that's an image after the PTK. The cornea is quite clear now, but if you have small points of that to the corneal surface of the granula, then these explain the double images or multiple images that he experienced, especially at night. So he couldn't function as he was before. And we fitted him scleral lenses and he is the happiest camper ever. Like he has never seen or hasn't seen for ages or decades as good as he was seeing now after removing some of the granuli and restoring the irregular surface. Since he has pinguecula nasally and some of it temporally, we had to notch the lens to avoid irritation or too much pressure on the pinguecula. You could go either larger, you could go either smaller, but in this case, you have to go really small in overall diameter. Some of the labs, they do micro vaults, so we have an area that you can vault the lens there to avoid pressure on the pinguecula. Yeah, so massive improvement of quality of life, and that's just why we do that. People are so happy, they are your customer for life, I believe, because you have made a huge difference to their lives. And I mean, he needs reading glasses, but that's the least of his complaints. He's happy to function like that. So it's maybe an unusual indication, but it's an irregular cornea. So what? We correct irregular cornea. And corneal dystrophy type 1 can reoccur after PTK. Maybe there's another PTK possible due to the rest of the stroma that we have to remove some of the stromal and the granuli. And the same lens basically, or practically the same geometry, can be put on top of this eye after the second PTK. After a perforated keratoplasty, we have to do a refit in general. Right, so we switch gears and look at other conditions that could benefit for scleral lenses. And there is exposition keratitis, severe dry eye conditions, due to different reasons. And we have cosmetic or prosthetic lens fits, where scleral lens can be used as a lens. We have traumatic or congenital changes. Here we have a case, a girl. She has, due to an accident, a facialis paresis and incomplete or no lid closure. Her ophthalmologist wanted to make the tarsography, that's a difficult word, the gold plates you put into the upper lid. And she was researching on the internet and found us and visited us, and we did a scleral lens on this eye. So she had burning, she had pain, red eyes, always foreign body sensation. Then we started with a scleral lens. She uses some goggle type of thing, or with a Band-Aid that she put on her top of her eyes overnight with gels in it. And yeah, that's with a scleral lens. It's about a 17 millimeter scleral lens. And in the morning, she has the most red eyes. Then she continues wearing the lens over the day. She doesn't do anything. Maybe sometimes lubrication and forcing lids to blink. At the end of the day, her eyes look the best and she feels the best. So these cases, they're so happy if you can help them. Maybe you have to like look with materials, or how do you fill the scleral lens, or how do you support the lubrication? Here we have not an amazing lubrication of the surface despite of the treatment with the Hydropec coating. And that's also, it's not a matter for her. She's happy just to feel good. Yeah, she's happy. Another indication would be graft versus host disease after bone marrow transplantation, where the lacrimal glands have less lacrimation and reduced tear prism. She had moderate to severe dry eyes symptoms. She had pain. She had photophobia. We had even filaments on the corneal surface and staining. Yeah, you could imagine she doesn't feel too good going out with these eyes. I was quite conservative because it was the first case with graft versus host disease, and we have the immunosuppressors. So if there's an infection going on, it's going very south. But instructing the patient, like having proper hygiene, having proper care plan, that would help. So I instructed her to use the lenses only 3 to 4 hours a day. So 1 month later, the top images of the right and left eye were really improved already. And then 3 months with the scleral lenses, wearing them 4 to 6 hours a day, the cornea was okay. No staining, no irritation on the cornea. And she couldn't remember how she was able to live without the scleral lenses, being in so much pain all the time and now feeling much more comfortable. So that's also a case where we could really help the patient. Following up here also every 3 months, making sure that there's no infection going on, having proper lid hygiene, so help the meibomian glands, that they still function, that we don't have too much keratinized lid margins, and so on. And proper lubrication for sure. So we have various pathological exposition keratitis cases that can be supplied and helped with scleral lenses in a great way. Try different insertion fluids, maybe gel art, hyaluronic acid, or even autologous serum in very severe cases, but you need to talk to the eye doctors. Literature also describes that large-scale erosions heal faster with scleral lenses than only with surface wetting or probably also with bandage lenses. So, patient and doctor education. So I hope none of these doctors will send them right away for surgery, but try other options first. There's a lot of literature for protective lenses. All right, so now we come to the cosmetic or prosthetic scleral lenses with partial or full occlusion. That's a girl about 15 years of age. She was born with a primary hyperplastic vitreous. So she has the wide pupil appearance, and we were able to fit her a lens just with a printed center part of the lens to imitate a pupil. That is without the lens. In normal light, she wasn't dilated, and that's with the scleral lens in place with the two eyes. She was looking at my camera, so she had a little bit of an azo convergence position. Also, after traumatic indications, I have two men, and both they had a gun accident. He had an accident with 12 years of age. Now he's 50 years old. He has an exposition of his injured eye, and he was wearing colored soft lenses. They oftentimes would fall out, and comfort was okay, but not good. And so he was referred to our practice, and we were able to fit him a scleral lens. And the beauty of it, you can decenter the part of the iris or the iris reconstruction, and we were able to make him more ortho alignments with a good eye than he was. Unfortunately, I have no image of the two eyes, but it looking nice. He's happy with it. That's another case. He also had an injury with a gun projectile a few years ago. The left eye, so it was shrinking and a huge irregular surface. So we were making a huge toric or huge toricity on this lens, and also a decentered print to match the other eye. It doesn't look as good in slit lamp. So with prosthetic colors, always look at natural light, because slit lamp, we have not the same illumination. We have a straight illumination compared to the normal illumination. That's the same patient, and it's looking quite good. It's not hand painted, so you always have a difference, but in most of the cases, they're happy and it's easy to do. This man, he has had multiple traumas, three injuries. I think two of them, he was is a truck driver, and he has to tighten his load. The thing, I don't know how it's called in English, was catapulting twice in his eyes, like in two different incidents. So he has no lens, superluxated lens. Then he has now an IOL, then twice keratoplasty, iris reconstruction, and so on. So bad eye. The fluorescein image is normal, so his eye looks like that if it's normal. And with retro illumination, you see, wow, beautiful church window appearance, but contrast-wise and optics aren't as good. But you also see that the IOL, probably from the second incidence, is a bit decentered from in the eye. So we try to make a lens look for the right hole, where you have to put it, where he's looking through. And we were able to achieve that with that lens. So we reduce a lot of blinding of light that enters in the iris. Without any lens, he's seeing maybe hand motion. Then with a scleral lens without the print, he's seeing 0.2, print 0.5. So it's not a lot, but the eye underwent a lot of surgeries. And now he's with this, he's still able, or is again able to drive his truck. I hope he learned from his lessons. So now we were talking about where to fit scleral lenses and where they could help people. And I just also want to touch on situations where it's difficult, where it's not possible, or be very cautious to fit lenses. For example, glaucoma with filtering blebs to release the intraocular pressure, they are oftentimes close to the limbal area. So be aware that you don't put pressure on those blebs to that the aqueous cannot flow out. So you have to microvolt those or have to have a notch out of the lens. It's possible to do, but just be aware and watch the intraocular pressure. In general, drug application, local drug application on the eye, I instruct the patient, do it before you put the lens in, maybe 15 minutes, so that we don't dilute the drug. And also after removing the lens, wait a couple of minutes or maybe 15 minutes to put the drops back in. That's an eye with Bafdalmos congenital glaucoma. This cornea has diameter H-vid of 16 millimeter. And that's a 16 millimeter lens. So I tried, but as you can see, this cornea is so soft, so fragile, and I was afraid that we were causing some damage with a socketed lens to the surface. So I stayed away. We stayed with the soft lenses with about 18 millimeter diameter, and that's working okay. Decompensation of the endothelial. The cut in general is around 800 cells per square millimeter. Below, oftentimes the cornea cannot pump the waters out enough, so we have edemas during the day. Even with modern scleral lens materials of DK over T, with 200. So if you have an old perforating keratoplasty or a Fuchs dystrophy or an old endothelial dystrophy graft, sometimes they cannot work with just too low on cell count. But I always approach it, try and watch corneal thickness and see if you can wear it. Most of the times you know it after a phase of 2 or 3 hours if the cornea is able to manage that or not. That's a case. He was diagnosed with Fuchs a few years later after he had LASIK, and we were fitting him with scleral lenses. But he always would have fluid in between the interface of the flap, also with graft, with the diazoic graft underneath. So he always was seeing a blurry or foggy, so he had to stop wearing the lenses. Even with 200 DK over T, it didn't work in that case. So yeah, what I instruct the patient also is, please don't put the lenses in the first thing in the morning, because we want to have the overnight edema to be gone until or before they place the lenses in. So we have a bit of a better outcome over the day to expect it. And also look at light in the morning. Do you see any halos or not? To just follow up the patients by themselves if the corneas is decompensating. Follicles. So, flipping eyelids in these days with corona is a pain. Gloves and stuff on, I hate it. But in scleral lens, I see sometimes follicles, even fluorescein positive underneath the tarsal conjunctiva in the upper lid. And we can imagine that we have a lot of friction on the surface. That's one part one. And the other part is that we have accumulated fatty acids on the surface on the lens. So most cases they work if we have a coated lens with Hydropeg. We have better friction and wetting properties, lower deposits tendency, and in most cases it works. But some cases they have to be supported with cortisone or steroid therapy. If you have allergy season, then also apply some allergy medication to the eye, because it can be related to that. It could look like this. So on the left side, we have fluorescein positive staining. On the right side, they're quite calm. Usually they don't go away, but I want to have him calm. In these cases, most of the time, if you have like a really bad surface wettability or some thing going on top of the lens, then flip the eyelid and look if there's something going on that we have to take care of first. So we're at the end. Scleral lens, I think, can be applied in many cases. That's just a handful of cases, and I believe that there are more cases that they can be fit on. Apply creativity. Add to your fitting experience from the normal scleral lenses and go into the more complicated cases. It's a scleral lens still, and strive for the best possible and tolerable fit, and do follow up. So that's my Votum scleral lenses of a perfect world applied in an imperfect world with the least possible compromises. Yeah, and restore vision and improve quality of life. That makes my day. If a patient is happy, can see, I recently had a customer, he was recently diagnosed with keratoconus, and he had some, I put my alarm clock. He was looking at his arms. Whoa, I didn't know that I have so much hair on my arms. He couldn't see that. So it's fun. And he was at the clinic today, and he still is happy. He couldn't imagine how he can function without the lenses. And I hope you have loads of those experiences too with your patients. And yeah, that makes our days. And now I'm open for questions. You can also find the presentation on our webpage. The direct link is here, but you find it on the webpage. Not yet, I need to put it on later on. All right, so if you have questions, type it in. Will you ask them, Guillaume, or how does that work?
Yeah, no worry. I will translate if it's needed. I have one question. Thank you first for the presentation. It was very interesting. My first question is about when you fit patient with Clairol, he tests it, he's very happy with, but you are not happy, so you have to stop the wearer. How do you announce it? So, because it's always very tricky to say to patient, yeah, you see, your life is better, your view is better, your vision is better, everything is better, but for your eyes it's not good, so you have to stop now.
Well, that's a good question. I hope and I tend to see them regularly so I don't end up there. I usually, if you see the patients in a regular base, then you can say, hey, if you're continuing with wearing the lenses for long hours, then we are ending up there where you cannot wear the lenses anymore. So please reduce wearing time. And then it's also a matter of inserting fluids, try different fluids, and so on. But if it's like decompensation of the cornea, they will know because they don't see anyway. So these patients, they are not too difficult to get them away. But yeah, there are some cases that were wearing the lenses too long. And one case I managed to fit in with RGPs for nighttime or after wearing the scleral lenses to reduce the wearing time because he couldn't see anything without any lens or without lenses. So he's wearing the sclerals during the day to drive, and at nighttime he's wearing the RGP lenses, and that helped a lot in his case. Did I answer your question? Not quite, but it's a difficult question.
Yeah, that's not bad. Okay, so do you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Also, question is: you can see in a discussion. Did you fail to fit scleral lens on the irregular cornea sometimes or never?
Do I fit? Can I see the questions? Where can I? Well, can you repeat the question, please?
Did you fail to fit scleral lenses on irregular cornea?
Do I fit scleral lenses on irregular cornea?
You did a fail.
Oh, yeah. What I don't do is imprint scleral lenses or customized scleral lenses in with the imprint. So some cases probably would be able to fit with those lenses.
And the second question is, did you fit prosthetic lenses on the LCIs? Because we know when prosthetic lenses decrease the transmissibility of oxygen, did you use this type of lens for LCIs?
I tried to avoid it, yes, because of that reason. We have a lot of reduction of oxygen transmissibility, and you even sometimes can see it after removing the lens that you have some edema in that area where the print is. So I try to avoid it, to do it on really the bad eye.
My question is about also when you do prosthetic scleral lens, because it's something very interesting, because I was thinking that when you add painting on the scleral lens, the decay will decrease a lot, maybe near zero or something like that. What do you think about? And I know that Falco doing this, so it's very interesting, because I think, I don't know a lot of people who are doing that on the scleral lens, so it's very interesting.
So we never measured decay over T, but it's basically zero.
Okay. So
we could switch back to PMMA.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. That makes sense. And also, there is another question is about: did you see any difference between for the stiffness of the sclera before or after putting some drugs or some things like that? Because, for example, if you have some people who put some I don't know which drugs you can put, but is the sclera become more stiff or not, or something like that? Do you see something like that before or not?
Like to improve the stiffness of the sclera, or any drugs that change the stiffness?
Yeah, exactly.
I would say not that I'm aware of. Okay. That I have seen like that, yeah.
And also, how do you define your first lens diameter or something like that? Because you have choice about many diameters, or which one
yes,
you choose?
Yes, I do. So first lens. I need topography because I have white to white measurement there, and if I have a small cornea, I go to a smaller lens with a smaller diameter of the scleral zone, where the scleral zone starts, and maybe a smaller overall diameter. And then I also tend to have a feeling if it's a deep eye or if it's a flat eye. If you look at the slit lamp and if you have 3D vision, you get a quite good impression how deep or how deep the sac has to be. Sometimes okay. Yeah, sorry.
No, it's a question is what for you, what is small or what is big?
So normal, for a normal eye, I fit 60 millimeters around there. Okay. So it's about 11.8 cornea to 12.2 cornea in that range.
Okay.
Yeah.
And And what's the minimum for you for the scleral diameter?
You meaning overall diameter?
Yeah.
That could go, well, depending on the size of the eye, I have micro cornea, where I have a 11.0 scleral lens, but that's a full scleral lens. So always I go by diameter of the HVID and maybe go 2 millimeters larger than that, 2 to 3 millimeters larger than HVID.
Okay, and for example, in your cases, about the, I don't know how to say that very clearly. So for the logophthalmus, which was the size of the scleral?
That was about 17.5.
Okay. Okay. Let me see. Okay, and how is the frequency of your follow-up for the scleral wearers? First, it's when you see them for the first time, and after how many months do you recommend or something like that?
So after I concluded the fitting procedure, then I see them every 6 months. That's a normal case. If you have a special case, then I see them maybe every 3 or 4 months. Have a tighter follow-up, and we also tell the customers that we change the lens after 1 year because of the we have a large surface, and if there are micro scratches and so on, lubrication is going south, and then we have problems with follicles and so on. So we plan for the second exam, we plan the change of the lens then. So one time we have in between, and one time we have a session where after we change the lens, or maybe ahead of that session.
Okay. Did you see the discussion or no in the, I'm not sure it's that, but in the buphthalmus, did you try a larger diameter or?
I was out of diameters of the lens, but if we go back, I was pushing that sclera. Watch the video. I was pushing the sclera next to the lens, so the whole eye, not only the cornea, but also the sclera, is soft as pudding. I don't know how to call it. So, I think it wouldn't make a huge difference with large lens, and I just was afraid of suction forces, because of such a soft tissue on the eye. Yeah.
Okay. And so let me check. Okay. Thibaut, did you have any question more?
No, I don't have any question. So a lot of thank you for Marcus.
Yeah, thank you very much, Marcus.
Yeah.
Thank you for being there and take your time to do that.
Yeah. And if you have any questions, sometimes just shoot me an email. It should be here. That you can reach me and we can discuss.
Je vous encourage même fortement à faire, à prendre contact avec Marcus si vous avez des questions ou des choses à lui parler. Il est très gentil et il est très très compétent. Donc c'est vraiment un plaisir de travailler, de pouvoir échanger avec lui. N'hésitez pas.
Merci beaucoup. Je comprends plus que French. Je parle. Hein?
Okay, so merci Marcus, and so. Next, maybe Thibaut, tu veux annoncer les prochains ou pas?
Non, vas-y, je te laisse la primeur quand même.
Non, vas-y, c'est toi qui as fait, vas-y.
Donc, lundi prochain, on aura la chance d'avoir Yves Van der Rop qui va nous faire une présentation. Donc, je pense que lundi prochain, 18h, il faut vraiment que tout le monde soit là. En plus, le sujet va être intéressant. Donc,
Lundi prochain. See you, Marcus.
Lundi prochain.
And yeah, if you want to come on next Monday to see Eve, you're welcome.
Thank you very much for having me, and I wish you a happy evening. Enjoy the nice weather and happy fitting. Thank you all.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.